This is a storage box for wood offcuts made from a single sheet of plywood, and this is a SketchUp model of this box. Now, the reason I drew it in such excruciatingly bright colors is because I also created this cutting list, and the colors simply make it easier to identify each of the pieces. If you want to use this cutting list to build your own box like this, there is a link to the SketchUp file in the description below. Please use it and share it as widely as you want. In the majority of YouTube videos, I see the maker chooses to break down the full-size boards themselves using either a table saw or a circular saw or something similar. Now, I understand that sometimes you can only cut a piece of wood once you are building the actual project and you need to sneak up on that very final measurement. But for building projects like this one and say something like cupboard carcasses, I try to have my boards pre-cut to size as often as I can. By spending just a bit more time on the design and thinking through a well-prepared cutting list, you can very often have your pieces cut for you to a very accurate dimension, which in turn, of course, will cut down your own work time, especially if you don't have loads of space to maneuver and process a full board. So while I struggle to get my angle of the camera sorted, let's quickly look at the notation I used on my cutting list. The first letter simply indicates the order in which the cuts are to be made, A, B, C, D, and so on. So here where it reads A rip 950, it simply means the operator will need to make this cut first. It is a rip cut as it runs across the length of the board and the saw needs to be set at 950 mm. This is then followed by the B1 and B2 cuts, which are the same width. And it is exactly for these multiple cuts at the same dimensions for which an industrial panel saw like this one simply cannot be beaten for accuracy and speed. Preparing a cutting list like this also makes it much easier for the operator, as all he needs to do is simply follow the order of the cuts until the whole board is cut to size. And if we flick back to the cutting list, you can now see that the board is completely broken down into its 7 constituent parts, with the gray pieces simply being offcuts. Now that we have it all cut, let's get on with building it. One thing I like to do at the very beginning of a project, especially if the pieces are roughly the same size, is to mark everything up using masking tape and a Sharpie. It just makes it easier to reference the pieces and prevents you from getting confused whilst working. So I started with the bottom of the box and I just marked out guidelines for where I wanted to drill my screw holes. And for this, I used these handy little guide holes on the side of my square to draw lines around the perimeter of each piece. This way, I am sure I'm screwing into the center of the edges. Now, this box is not a piece of furniture. It's going to stand in the wood shop and collect bits of wood. So there's no real reason to hide the screw heads. I still do like it when the screws are symmetrical. And again, you can see that these guide holes make it very quick and easy to mark out exactly where I need to drill. And when it comes to drilling, more often than not, I would use a countersink drill like this one you're seeing here. It doesn't take any more time and it makes the final project just look that little bit tidier and rounded. So now that I've done that, I moved on to the back and followed the same process of marking, measuring, drilling before moving on to the two sides. These are the purple pieces in the model. And although I didn't need to drill any holes in them, I had to cut the angles to give the box its different depths. To make sure I had the exact length, I used the front, the yellow piece in the model, to mark it directly onto the side I wanted to cut, which is always more accurate than measuring it. Then I marked the distance at the top, which gave me the correct angle I had to cut. But as I was using my circular saw to make this cut, I had to draw another parallel line for the fence guide to run against. And to do this, I simply used a compass set to the width of the guide rail and drew 2 reference points, and then I simply made the cut. So far, so good. Before assembling the whole thing, I did a dry fit just to see if it all works together. And I don't think there's a right or wrong to this. It's just a matter of checking to see if everything feels right and fits. And it also gives me a chance to think through the assembly. Once happy with that, I attach one piece at a time by gluing up the edges and screwing it all together. And here you can see how having pre-drilled holes just makes it much easier. What was that? You want a notification each time I publish a new video? Click the bell button below. Easy. Now, normally the screws will be enough to pull the 2 pieces of wood closely together. But if it doesn't, you can always use a clamp to tighten it up and close any small gaps before screwing it. Using your head as an additional hand isn't exactly textbook, but whatever works. Then it's just a matter of gluing and screwing everything together piece by piece until you are done. As I said at the start of the video, I see very little point in spending much time on finishing a box meant for storing bits of wood, but cut plywood is quite splintery and sharp, and as you'll be reaching into it and touching it, it is worth just to take off those edges a little. For this, I just spent 5 minutes with a small block plane and I think up to 100 grit sandpaper, and trust me, your hands will thank you for this over the years to come. To fit the dividers, I used two pieces of wood with the same width as spacers and screwed them into place. Finally, as I wanted to be able to move the box around from time to time, I fitted it with four casters, two of which have brakes. Having a box like this, it really does make a big difference in just keeping my workspace tidy, which in turn, obviously, it just makes it faster and more enjoyable to get any of my projects done. I made this box to fit into this specific gap in my workshop, but I also designed one that is the maximum size you can get out of a single sheet of plywood. You can download the SketchUp file with both size boxes and their cutting list. If you don't have SketchUp, I even made a PDF for you. So please download and share and let me know how you got on in the comment sections below. Until next time, goodbye.